GOLDINVEST. Explore opportunity.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to the latest GOLDINVEST interview, an update with Ucore Rare Metals CEO, Pat Ryan. We want to hear what's up at Ucore and also what his thoughts are on the latest developments in the sector. Welcome, Pat.
Hey, great to be here.
So, Pat, as we just discussed, our last talk was actually just a couple of days before Ucore announced pretty significant news. You were granted $18.4 million by the U.S. Department of Defense, which is a great vote of confidence. Your company, what is the money supposed to help you achieve?
Yeah, we were very pleased with the add-on to our OTA. It's another transaction agreement that we have with the Department of Defense. You may recall that we had an original $4 million U.S. investment. That was to test our technology and to run many hours on our commercial demonstration plant, which is in Kingston, Ontario, Canada. And as we approached the end of that particular program and we were comparing all our metrics to solvent extraction, which is typically used for rare earth processing, the DOD was very pleased with what they saw with our column-based technology and the fact that we had metrics of operational parameters that were much better than solvent extraction, better footprint, better ESG template, better CapEx for sure, better deployment of capital, meaning you go forward in a scalable modular way. And with that, they wanted to move from the commercial demonstration, which is what the $4 million was, onto what they called a phase two of the program, which is now to commercialize. And so if commercialize, we had a brownfield building in Louisiana, Alexandria, Louisiana. We've had that for a couple of years now, waiting to deploy our technology inside that building, really a copy and paste of what we've done at Kingston, and now build the same type of column technology in Louisiana. Now, the Louisiana plant will take its growth in three stages. And those three stages are essentially modular, scalable deployment of rapid SX technology. The first phase will generate between 2,000 and 2,500 tons of total rare earth oxides. Second stage will double that to 5,000. The third stage will double it to 10,000 of total rare earth oxides. So what the Department of Defense has done is said, hey, you're ready for a commercialization. Let's get some funding in place to get going with that first stage. The infrastructure for stage one has been funded or partially funded, and rapid SX machines, as we call them, in that stage one, there are five machines that we're building. And there's actually three of them that through our recent DOD and some other funding that we have, we're able to support three machines in Louisiana to get going. So it's early stage production by mid-26, and all of that DOD money goes towards now engineering and development and civil site works and everything you would do as you're building a production plant.
Okay, so essentially the way for you to speed things up.
Yeah, you can't go quick enough unless you have capital. So now with the capital, we can certainly accelerate our timelines.
Very good. Where are you at in that regard? I mean, the groundbreaking ceremony was end of May, I think. So we're nearing end of July. What work has already been done?
Yeah, the end of May, May 29th, we had our groundbreaking in Louisiana. It was very well attended. The Speaker of the House in the U.S., Mike Johnson, that's his territory. And he had representatives from his house that were there. Congresswoman Julia Letlow, Senator Cassidy's office was there. And the Department of Defense showed up along with the state and other federal people and local people that were there for the groundbreaking. We had a couple hundred representatives there. Department of Defense itself brought in some key people. They gave a speech about how the facility we have in Alexandria is a key part of their supply chain growth going forward. And it was very well received. Since then, you're right, we've taken our local engineering firm Orbital, and they've been doing some civil site work, charted the whole inside of the building for CAD model development so we can take our process flow sheets that are being developed and plug that into the actual space that we have in Alexandria. So it's well underway just a month after the groundbreaking.
Okay, well, that's good to hear. Now, that's not the only thing you're working at. I think you raised, since we spoke, or Ucore itself raised $15.5 million in this case, I think. Can you tell us what that money is meant for, what you're working on there?
Yeah, we knew that with the $18.4 US that were raised, along with the $4 million before that, we knew that it was time to actually make sure that our bank was ready to really deploy and get the plan in place. So we put in place a life raise, which is a raise you can put in place once a year, listed issuer financing exemption, it's called. And we had planned to raise about $10 million Canadian. And we used the news of the DOD to make that happen. We were working with the people from Raymond James, a big bank here in North America, and Red Cloud. And between the two of them, we had made a number of non-investment roadshow presentations to some of their key institutional investors here in the North American world, and some of them were from Europe as well. And in a matter of when we decided we were going to put the raise forward, we actually opened the raise and closed the raise within one day. We had topped up $10 million in one day, and then we had to make a decision and we wanted to overrun that, and we decided we would overrun it. And we ran it up to 15.5. We could have gone further, but we thought, no, 15.5 was plenty. And so now we've got a good bank of capital. You need capital to build buildings, need capital to engineer and move forward and buy equipment and buy feedstock and do all the things that are required. We've got very robust economic models that show what we need. As you know, the summer months could be a little slow. We didn't want to be stuck with an opportunity in the summer where we thought, you know, we should raise a few more dollars, and that would be tough to do in the summer months. So we acted quickly at the end of June. And here we are today, cashed up and with an engineering team working at full speed through the summer months.
Okay, great. Yeah, you know, it's often a lull in the summer month, but now you can keep going very well. And so you're working on different aspects of the business, so to speak, and making progress, obviously, on all fronts. I mean, not only in this situation, the market as a whole that we talked about last time already, the need for Western supply chains for rare earth and all that, but also that the Department of Defense of the U.S. also cut a deal with MP Materials, which is, I think, the only producing rare earth materials, let's say, producing company in the U.S. And I think they agreed to a minimum price for some of the products that are going to be produced there. Can you tell us your thoughts on that, what that means for the sector?
Yeah, absolutely. I think the main thing is, and people look at it and they go, there's a floor price of $110 that was set for NdPr, which is about twice the spot price of China. And so all the up and coming developing, whether they're midstream capacity people or whether they're mines, they look at that and they go, well, that helps make the economic playing field a little more attractive. And certainly for investors, makes it more attractive with a floor. But the thing that we saw that we really liked was that with your trade war negotiations going on, particularly between China and the U.S., our biggest fear is that the U.S. would just say, okay, let's negotiate the tariffs, let's negotiate our deals, let's see who gets what. That they would decide that China would provide a certain amount of rare earth product to the U.S. market or to the Western market based on trade war negotiations. And we thought that would be a dangerous spot to be, because geopolitics being what they are, it's just going to pop up again and you still don't have a solution. So the U.S. has really said, we're not going to rely on the trade wars to solve our issue. We're going to actually make investments, significant investments, to be able to show that we're taking charge of the Western world supply chain. And so that's what the MP to us represented most significantly. It does have a floor price mechanism, which is good. But the fact that the DOD has said, we're going to take charge of matters of supply chain, you know, robustness ourselves, that's key. And that works for Ucore, because our most valuable asset, of course, is apart from our technology, which is very good and scalable and modular, and smart capital deployment, et cetera, it's that relationship with the DOD. And so now the DOD looks at us, in particular from the heavy rare earth side. That deal with MP was primarily for NdPr. There's some money carved away for developing heavy rare earth, but there's no plan in place yet. Ucore has been working aggressively on heavy rare earth production. That's where the DOD has wanted us to focus. We see that as a very good thing. Essentially, an optimum position would be that eventually, in our continued discussions with DOD, we'll end up with a floor price for heavy rare earth. And if we're able to establish a floor price for heavy rare earth, now the economics become assured all over. The Western supply chain gets a heavy rare earth and a light rare earth price marker to work with. And it's all supported by DOD, again, not by, let's see what China decides after we have a trade war.
You know, that's certainly, I agree with you there. That way is a much smarter and much surer way to keep things going. So great. Thank you for that. So that's exciting stuff for Ucore. A lot of things happening, a lot of moving parts in the air, things you have to do. And we know that you're aiming for first production, let's say mid of 2026. But what can we expect from the company in sort of news flow for the remainder of the year?
Well, yeah, absolutely. One of the main things are definitive feedstock agreements. And we're working with three particular areas of the world right now where there are mines that are either running or very close to running, and they will become inputs for Louisiana for 2026, or at least two of the three will. We've got three that are very robust. We've got one in Brazil, we've got one in the Far East, and not China, and we have one in Australia. So you'll hear more about definitive feedstock agreements that come into play. On the offtake side, now that we're funded by the DOD, we have the life raise in place. All the players that we've been dealing with downstream for offtakes are very much in tune with the fact that Ucore is now executing its plan. It has a timeline. It has three stages of production rollout. And we're being very selective about our offtake partners, but you'll hear about offtake partners as well. You'll also hear about at least one, maybe two strategic equity investments. We're not looking to bring on more equity just in general right now, but strategic equity could be very helpful to the company. And we're considering that as well. You know, there's some interesting moving pieces that are happening right now. We don't know the particulars of the deal that just was cut between the U.S. and Japan. But as you know, we've been very actively involved with the Japanese side of things in looking to bring some of their expertise back to America in the form of magnet making, whatnot. And so that plays a significant role in the playing field too here with the supply chain going forward. And then your updates from Louisiana. You know, now we're engineering, we're building buildings, we're putting in larger columns, we're putting in front-end equipment, back-end equipment, and it's going very well. Having capital is great, and anyone in this space that's trying to move forward to be capitalized is certainly in a good position to have capital. But capital doesn't solve the problem. What solves the problem is a very good technology that can be deployed. We've got that. Economics that are robust, we've got that. And also people that can get the job done. And so I'm not going to use names here, but in the last 2 months, we've hired three key individuals, one who actually built and was a project manager for a solvent extraction plant, heavy and light, that's now joined the Ucore team, managing our project in Louisiana. One who's a PhD in solvent extraction, very skilled and understands our technology now and really likes what he sees. He will be in charge of the technology side of making sure it's deployed effectively on a commercial scale. A third person was our operations manager who has been involved with running rare earth processing facilities, and they've joined the team as well. And again, I'm not using names. We're being a little careful about our portfolio going forward, but needless to say, we've got the people now to execute and get the job done. So that too will become known as we move forward here in the last part of 25 into 26.
So it looks like it's going to be a busy year, even more busy than it was so far, if that's even possible. And we're very much looking forward to that news flow, and we'll get back to you and get talking again once we hear more. Thank you.